Welcome back. So this is second lecture on data center network. As we discussed in the lecture one, the data center networks will consisting of the physical machines as well as storages, networking devices like switch, routers, cables and power distribution system. At the same time, cooling system is also we need to have to establish a data center network. So in communication infrastructure, usually the cloud was described as the topology as well as routing, switching equipment, and at the same time protocols we need to have. We also discussed about the cost and number of humans worked in a data center. So usually in 2008, the data center staff as well as servers ratio is 1:1,000, but today the ratio is increased to 1:10,000, and millions of servers, billions of users, trillions of objects we have scale and scale out instead of scale up, and massive scale in the same location eases design and lower costs. Data center strategically placed where the power is cheap and close to consumers. So as we also discussed about geo distribution, and if you consider the network computing has been around forever, like just like grid computing, high performance computing and cluster computing. Highly specialized like nuclear simulation, stock trading, weather prediction, and we need to have some sort of cooling systems for the data centers too. So we know everyone wants to operate the internet scale. We have millions of users are there. Can our website survive to flash mob? And gigabytes of data is there to analyze, as well as along with web servers logs, advertisements and social networks, blogs, Twitter and video. So not everyone has the expertise to build the cluster. So the internet is symptom and the cure. Let someone else to do it for us. Whatever the needs we have, that has to be satisfied by someone application. The main goal of the data center is address the limitations of today data center networking architecture. That is, if any single point of failure or oversubscription of links higher up in the topology, that is trade-offs between cost and the providing. We need to consider the key design goals. That is, the goal number one is allow hosts communication at line speed. That is, no matter where they are located, wherever they are located, that has to allow host communication at line speed. Backwards compatible with existing infrastructure, that is no charges in an application, support of layer 2 just like Ethernet, and it should be cost effective. That is, we need to have cheap infrastructure and allows power consumption as well as heat emission methodologies. We also discussed various topologies like class topology, fat tree as well as fat tree. In all these, the optimization diffusion maybe have flow classification as well as flow scheduling. So in flow classification, what it will do is it will eliminate the local congestion, assign to traffic to ports on a peer flow basis instead of per host basis. In the case of flow scheduling, eliminates the global congestion. Instead of having the local congestion, it eliminates global congestion. It prevent long-lived flows from sharing the same links, assign long-lived flows to different links. These two are the optimizations in diffusion. And we have some drawbacks in this also. These drawbacks also we discussed in lecture one. No internet support for wireless LAN traffic. This is one drawback. Data center is fixed in size and ignored connectivity to the internet, waste of address space which require NAT at border. So we also discussed various components as well as approaches required for monsoon. As we also discussed the basic differences between data center as well as cloud computing. And if you, in that we considered the various case studies like Google File System and Google MapReduce, at the same time some other examples called Amazon and open source systems like Hadoop. So in these, lots of data has to be stored and lots of data is available for us, and the copies of web, satellite data, user data, email and Usenet, supervention backing store. So all these sorts of data is available in the various data centers. So the workloads are large as well as easily personalizable. We can have easily personalizable. No commercial system big enough, which could not afford if there was one, might not have made appropriate design choices. But truckloads of low-cost machines, 450,000 machines as per the analysis. Failures are the normal case. Even reliable system failed at Google scale. Software must be tolerate failures. We should care about the things called which machine an application is running on should not matter. Firm believes that end-to-end arguments. So these are that Google File System is having various building blocks like RAS storage, cluster scheduler, which will schedule jobs onto the machine, log service, just like Chubby, distributed log manager we have. It also reliably hold tiny files, that is up to hundreds of bytes. 5 replicas need of majority vote. And like another example for another building block of Google system is Bigtable, which is a multi-dimensional database, and MapReduce, which will simplify it, large scale data processing. And the Google File System has different points in the design space. So component failure as the norm, optimize for huge files, success used actively by Google to support search service as well as other applications, and performance may not be good for all apps. That is assumes read once, write once workload. If we consider this one, and this Google File System provides, it also provides fault tolerance, that is replicating data fast as well as automatic recovery. In data center, the major theme is what are the new networking issues posed by large scale data centers, which includes the architecture of the network, that is framework, and the design of topology, addressing issues, routing issues, as well as forwarding issues. These are the theme we have in that. If we consider the data center in interconnection structure, whatever the nodes we have in the system, that racks of servers we have, that is several racks we have, in each rack we have some set of servers. And how are the nodes interconnected? How these each and every individual server has interconnected? So usually we will use hierarchical interconnection structure, but Cisco recommended data center structure called starting from bottom level, that is rack switches, 1-2 layers of aggregation switches, layer 2 switches, access routers and core routers. So instead of representing core to access switches, instead of that we are having from bottom to top. So these are the basic design requirements for a data center. So in these data centers we have two types of applications, that is outward as well as internal components. So outward facing in the sense serving web pages to the users, that is from the internet we are accessing the data which is available in the data center. At the same time, the second type of application is internal components, just like MapReduce for web indexing. So these workloads are often unpredictable, We cannot predict how much workload is entered into the data center via the core router. So multiple services run concurrently within a data center, and for some services there is a huge demand and for some services there is a less demand based on the priority or based on the importance of that particular job that has to be processed. So it will spike off the demands for new services, that means success. But this is when the success spells trouble if not prepared. So failures are usually when we have thousands of servers, among them some there is a probability of getting failure. So when it is fails, we need to recall that Google file system, MapReduce, etc. resort to dynamic reassignment of chunk users and traffic matrix we need to consider. And if we consider the whatever the traffic matrix we have, that should be in between servers or changing constantly. So the overall data center design goal is usually whatever the components we discussed now, that is servers, power infrastructure and power draw network. So these servers include which includes again sub components like CPU, memory as well as disks. So 45% of the total cost to establish a data center will be meant for to purchase the servers, and to purchase power infrastructure almost 25% of budget was allocated, like UPS, cooling and power distribution, and 15% for networking components called switches, links as well as transit. So based on the components, the total cost may vary. And server costs are usually the servers are having more cost, and network cost also significant. So to achieve the agility, means any server can serve any task. Whatever the tasks we have, that can be served by any one of the available servers. So turn the servers into single large fungible pool. So let services breathe dynamically, expand and contract their footprint as needed. So we already see how this was done in terms of Google file system as well as MapReduce. So we have some benefits with the agility. So increase service developer productivity, lower cost as well as achieve high performance as well as reliability. So that means whatever the service we need, that service can be acquired from any one of the available servers, which includes the service may have workload management or the storage management or the network management. So if it is workload management, it means rapidly installing the service code on a server and the dynamically cluster scheduling and server assignment like MapReduce as well as Bigtable, what we discussed here, and virtual machines, disk images. So in case of storage management, the server may have provide services for access the persistent data and distributed file system like GFS. In the case of network management, to achieve agility, means of communicating with other servers regardless of where they are in the data center. So achieve high performance as well as the reliability. So to achieve this agility, we need to have some objectives called networking objectives. So the main objectives, which includes uniform high capacity, that is capacity between servers limited only by their NICs, that is network interface cards. No need to consider the topology when adding servers. That is high capacity between two any servers, no matter which racks they are located. At the same time, the second objective is performance isolation. That means the traffic of one service should be unaffected by others. And the third objective is ease of management, that is plug and play system. So flat addressing, so that any server can have any IP address. So server configuration is same as the LAN. Legacy applications depending on broadcast must work. So if we virtualized data center. So as we discussed now, whatever the data center architecture is adequate to us, or is today's data center architectures are adequate enough? So in this case, so as we know, we have hierarchical network, that is 1+1 redundancy we have. The equipment higher in the hierarchy handles more traffic, that is more expensive, more efforts made at availability. Servers connect via 1 Gbps UTP to top of rack switches, as we discussed in the topologies. So other links are mix of 1 Gb, 10 Gb, fiber or copper. So uniform high capacity means what? Performance isolation. What is meant by performance isolation? So agility in terms of dynamically adding or shrinking servers means what? And ease of management. These are the major objectives we have, and whatever the data center architectures we have now, these data center architectures are adequate enough. So for that, we have a concept called virtualized data center. So that means virtualized means without any physical devices, we are having the virtualized devices. So if we have virtualized, if the storage is virtualized, then we can call it as virtual storage. And if the devices are virtualized, like switches, routers, then we can call it as virtualized network devices and virtualized servers. So collection of virtual resources like virtual machine, virtual switches and virtual links. So this is the example for virtualized data center. Here we have we can see in the image, here we have the physical data center, and the colored line mapping of virtual switch to physical switch and mapping of virtual machine to server. So this is the physical data center we have. In this variable aggregate switches we have, core switches we have, and for this, these servers are connected with the virtual server. So we are with this, we are creating one virtual data center one, and here we have created another virtual data center two. So if suppose if we are saying that data center means a combination of interconnection between the servers as well as routers. So if the data center is in distributed manner based on the geographic regions or the geographic area, if the data center is distributed, then how each and every data center will be interconnected, we'll see now. So a network of data centers. So most traffic in an internet service provider network originates in a data center like Google, Facebook and Limelight. So these are the various data centers we have, and these are interconnected, and how we are accessing the data from outside world. So for example, equip routers with a content store, and the popular content to realize a more favorable memory bandwidth trade-off. So these are the strategies. And once the when it require very large caches, the content delivery is a business needing computing power. The data centers can also do routing inside that. So data centers or Most data centers today we have hierarchical structure with multiple alternative paths between thousands of servers. If suppose this is the internet, we have core routers and we have aggregation switches and then access switches, then top of racks we have several set of servers. And for example, single user networks, if we consider the Facebook, which can introduce proprietary protocols, servers and networks shared by different services. So some are multi-tenant data centers like Amazon. So must ensure isolation and meet SLAs. That means from multiple locations we can access the information from Amazon with the same user ID, that is multi-user. So if we consider the flow, let us here in this image, from the server to the server, and how much data is flowed. A sparse traffic matrix with pronounced locally, high variable flow sizes, query traffic is less than 2 KB, updates 50 KB to 1 MB, fresh data 1 MB to 50 MB, blusty flows arrivals. So TCP proves inadequate for bandwidth sharing. Big flows beat up little flows in small shared buffers. This is output queue, and these symbols will be treated as very large flows and these are small flows. Simultaneously the data will be shared. So TCP proves if inadequate bandwidth for sharing by these are the various senders. We have sender 1, sender 2 up to sender n, and these are connected to switch, and this is a bottleneck, and here we have a receiver. From all these, multiple datas are passing through the switch or bottleneck to the receiver. So if you consider the congestion control, so TCP proves the many protocols we have for congestion control protocols. These are the various protocols we have, and here link is provided. So if anybody interested, we can go through this. As effectiveness relies on universal adoption, this is not obviously practical in a multi-tenant data center. So multipath forwarding to elevate congestion. So using MPTCP packet spreading, we will see how the data will be flowed. You can see the colored line. Then sharing the data center network. Here we have vSwitch, virtual switch, and we have bandwidth, and these are the virtual machines VM1 to VMS, and this is group of virtual machines, second group of virtual machines, third group of virtual machines. So in this we need to construct or we need to build a traffic matrix so that we can have the information about the bookings as well as bandwidth consumed for that particular transmission, and reverse virtual data centers from a given traffic matrix with or without overbooking. So which will perform weighted fare sharing between entities using congestion control and weighted fare scheduling like net share, fare cloud. So if we consider weighted fare share, we have some set of servers and some data is passing towards upstream and some is passing towards downstream. So based on the virtuals, so these are the VM instances which will the net share will propose the weighted fare link sharing with a weight equal to minimum upstream as well as downstream VM instances. See, the upstream as well as downstream. So this Faircloud proposes weighted fairlink sharing with weight equal to sum of upstream as well as downstream virtual machine weights. You can see in the image. So in fact, both NetShare as well as Faircloud are more complicated than this. So anyway, the data center traffic characterization reveals bursty arrivals of flows of highly variable size. So all the above are evaluated assuming fixed patterns in flows. So bandwidth reservation does not meet the user requirements and it is generally unnecessary. So service differentiation by weighted sharing has unpredictable performance. It is not difficult to ensure excellent quality of service for all. So the concept of turning the cloud into future internet, for that we need to define the network infrastructure and elaborate the network structure. So this is DC interconnect of TCP options. We have three options: either we may connect with dark fiber and MPLS or IP. These are the four different data centers we have: site A, site B, site C, site D. Each is having the structure like this: DC core, aggregation switches, access switches. So all these are connected with dark fiber, very thick fiber. So this dark fiber is applicable for short distances, that is less than 100 kilometers. MPLS, multi-protocol level switching. Instead of having individual protocols for each and every task, all these tasks are combined together to which will be operated by MPLS. So applicable if enterprise is ready to deploy MPLS in core. So this service can be self-deployed or managed service from SP, that is directly attached to layer 2 VPN or the carrier supporting carrier. If it is IP, applicable for majority of customers with no dark fiber or MPLS, just like Ethernet. So these three are the transport options. We may use any one of these. So if it is dark fiber, it assumes that the dark fiber is connected between among the sites. So distance limitations are given by DWDM. A number of sites can be two or more sites can be connected with the dark fiber. You can see here we are adding two switches. Here one switch and here is one switch in the data center. These two switches use the different lambda to interconnect. So once they connected, these switches will form VSS and repeat the similar principle for all the sites so that all sites will become interconnected. So if it is MPLS, and layer 2 extension loop prevention. This is site A and site B. So we have this local STP and here we have another local STP and these are the core routers, how it will be preventing the loop. When loop is formed, then the data will not be transmitted. So this is the basic layout of multiple data centers. We have data center A, data center B, data center C, all these are connected with MPLS. If it is IP, we are connecting like this, site A to site B, site C, and internet service provider network. These are the various service providers, and this is data center version 3, third generation data center structure. And here we have 1 GB server access, and here we have 10 GB server access, and this is storage. Remaining, we have the various servers and the core router, aggregation switches and access switches. This is the basic portfolio of data center version 3. So thank you. If you have any queries, you can ping me on my mail ID. Thank you.